Tonight, the personal story of Andy Grove and coming to the United States, having survived the Nazis and the Soviets.
It wasn't hard because it was painful. It was hard because I was torn between, was I really discriminated against or am I whining about it? And I knew I was discriminated against, but when I talked about it, I didn't like myself complaining about it. I don't like complainers. I don't like to be a complainer. So it's a push and pull between wanting to talk about how I was treated, but feeling reticent to talk about it because of what it made me sound like.
And Peter Bergen talks about his interview with Osama bin Laden several years ago.
So you've seen a sort of evolution of his and a more radical attacks against Americans in his rhetoric. But why he chose to do this, I think he basically wanted to tell the world that he was at war with Americans. And I think a lot of people took that as sort of a rhetorical flourish. It turned out to be, deadly serious.
And we remember Ernst Gombrich, one of the leading art historians in the world, who died in London at age 92.
My story, in a certain sense, is a story of the conflict between two opposing problems or methods of representing the world, which in a simplified form you can say you draw what you know or you draw what you actually see. And the problem of the coming of what was to happen afterwards is represents really the story of our century.
Grove, Bergen, and Gombrich when we continue.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Andrew Grove is here. He is best known as an early visionary of the computer revolution. He was a CEO of Intel for more than a decade. He is still its chairman. During his tenure there, he oversaw the company's widespread expansion and led it to become the world's leading chip maker. While securing his place as an industry leader, Andy Grove long kept private the painful history of his own upbringing in Hungary. In his new memoir, Swimming Across, he describes that childhood in occupied Hungary and his eventual escape to the West at the age of 20. He is a friend of mine, he's a friend of this broadcast, and I am pleased to have him here because this is a powerful memoir that many of his friends have wanted him to tell, and we are pleased that he has told this story because a lot of reasons, and I'm pleased to have him here. I am deliberately, because I think this is such an important story to tell, not going to do all the things I would normally do to you, is sort of ask you where the future's going and all those kinds of things.
Well, that's a relief.
Only on the condition that you will allow me to come do that at another time.
Anytime.
Okay. You finally decided that you should do this because?
Because I became a grandfather. And the realization struck that by the time my grandchildren are going to be old enough to understand my story, I'll be too old to tell it to them. And my kids and my wife and my family and close friends have heard most of the stories in that book. Not in context, not in sequence, but they've heard them.
Not at one telling, so to speak.
Not in one telling, and not in an orderly fashion. So I had practiced telling the story in bits and pieces, but 20 years from now, the chances that I'll be able to tell those stories and do justice to them is less likely.
That's the most important reason.
That is.
1997, I think it was, you were Time Magazine's Man of the Year. And then a Time Magazine reporter came and wanted to know more about the influences that had shaped.
Correct.
That made a difference.
That made a difference in the sense that that was the first time somebody got me to talk about it publicly at all. And so the two things actually, you're very correct, coincided in late 97, Josh Ramo, was the writer of that story, cracked through my reticence of talking about it in public. And in 97, I became grandfather for the first time, so I had an audience for this story. So I started thinking about it. So I told Time magazine, and is Time magazine the only thing I'm going to leave for my grandchildren? I can do a bit better. At least I thought I could do a bit better. We'll see.
Well, you have done better. You had not told it before because...
I've been on your show a number of times. You want to talk about technology, you wanted to talk about Intel, you wanted to talk about the industry.
Then I want to talk about you.
I didn't want to talk about circumstances like this. It's kind of, the two subjects have nothing to do with each other. Everybody has a past and a legacy. Mine happens to be including wars and repression and the like. I didn't want to use that to publicize my Intel story any more than I would like to use the Intel story today to publicize my personal story.
But it was that. It wasn't because it was something that the pain was too much or the sheer sense of retelling the story.
Not really, because then I wouldn't have told my family about it. It was never difficult to talk about it to an audience that I thought was interested, and my family was interested in it. I told it several times, this particular story. When I wrote the book, I wrote a sample chapter to see what the narrative would look like. And this chapter I chose was a story of how I got out of Hungary, how I got across the border. I chose that partly because it's dramatic, and partly because I've told that so many times that I thought it would be the easiest to tell, and it was easy to tell.
Yeah. Harder to tell is when you saw your father coming back.
True. And some other stories were even harder than that.
Like which ones?
My mother's encounter with Russian soldiers.
You were taken out of the room when...
Correct.
She was treated badly.
Yes.
And others?
I think the general sense of being persecuted, picked on, discriminated against because of being Jewish. It wasn't hard because it was painful. It was hard because I was torn between, was I really discriminated against, or am I whining about it? And I knew I was discriminated against, but when I talked about it, I didn't like myself complaining about it. I don't like complainers. I don't like to be a complainer. So it's a push and pull between wanting to talk about how I was treated, but feeling reticent to talk about it because of what it made me sound like.
You have no interest in going back to Hungary?
Not really.
Not really?
No. No interest. The country that never made me feel wanted when I was an ordinary kid growing up, student, high school student, university student, I was always reminded that I didn't belong there. So why should I want to go back there?
The interesting thing, you wanted in the beginning to be a writer, journalist.
True.
Wouldn't that be fun if Andy Grove was one of our colleagues?
Well, after a fashion I am. I've written a bunch of stories.
That's
written
true,
a
you have.
Books.
Yeah.
Not exactly reporting.
No, but telling a story.
Right.
Yeah, telling a story. Telling a story of your battle with prostate cancer.
That was personal enough.
That was very personal. I mean, I never understood why that.
I had a mission.
To educate people.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find that when you start writing this kind of thing, you remember much more than you thought you did?
I did not know what to expect. When I started putting things to paper, I kind of let memories flow, and I had no idea whether I had enough for a book or a short story or a little 10-page memoirs that I would just keep in the family. And when recollections flowed, they dragged with them other recollections. And when eventually they stopped dragging new recollections and I stopped, I counted there were 250 scenes, kind of picture a scene in a movie, flashback of a particular event, certain people doing certain things. That was a scene, that was a page. There were 250 such pages, 250 such scenes. I kind of figured by the time I embellish those and drop some of them and combine some of them, it's going to be a book-length story, and it turned out to be right that. But I had no idea whether I'm going to end up with 10 of those scenes or 500 of them.
Mm. What impact did Angela's Ashes have on you?
Angela's Ashes was my role model. By the way, in all fairness, I should mention that I read Angela's Ashes around the time I started thinking about the book, about writing a book like that. And then I read the story of this Irish boy, young man, who comes to America at age 20 and parallels my story in many ways. And what grabbed me is the masterful way Franklin Court tells that story from the perspective of a 5-year-old, a 7-year-old, a 12-year-old. And I was looking at it as, I wonder if I can do that. So the competitive juice started flowing a little, and not that I ever pretend to reach. I mean, the man is a pro lyrical writer, and you know, I'm an engineer turned into writer. So I can't hope to equal him, but that was my role model.
And you learned that it was instructive to you about telling
the story as the person that was me at a given age could conceivably have seen, the levels of observation that was really embedded in what I remember.
And what he remembered and what you remembered. And
right.
September 11th came, a battle against terrorism. Did you say, oh my God?
I said, oh my God, but I said one more thing.
One more thing.
Do I have to go through this again? A moment of, I had to have to admit, self-pity.
Self-pity?
Yeah, I mean, September 11th wasn't about me. September 11th was about thousands of people who died and tens of thousands of family members and the like. And so, I have to admit that it was a self-centered thought, but I looked at it, I've been through a war, world war, I've been through revolutions, been through repression, now this. So that was my immediate reaction. And subsequent in conversations I found that from other people who have gone through the war, that there's a common reaction.
Oh my God, here come them, do I have to do this again?
Yeah.
Part of the reason people want to write this book, others, A, because they admire you and they think that there's a powerful personal story. They also believe that this story will give us insight into the man, that it will show us what makes Andy tick. Do you think it does?
If it does, I would be the last person to recognize it. I don't see the connection between these events and how it turned out.
No causal effect, relationship.
I don't think so. Just kind of just a common sense look at it. Millions of people went through the same experience. Thousands of people went through the same experience who ended up in my field, in my business or related businesses. They all turned out differently. They all led different lives. We are individuals who, when put into the crucible of a certain set of events, a certain environment, our makeup plus that crucible result in an adult of a particular brand, particular kind. So I don't think you can draw too many analogies. I know it's tempting because everybody tries to do that, but...
Well, that's what they expected they would understand, you know that.
Yeah.
But you don't see it.
I don't see it.
Is it because you don't know who... I mean, do you think you understand who Andy is and what makes Andy tick yourself? Or is that the kind of thing that you becoming, because you're an engineer,
I don't
would not have any interest in you. Understanding who I am and what makes me tick and why I am the way I am just has little interest.
It has little interest, and if it had any interest in it, I would be very dubious of my ability to sort these things out. I'm really more interested in what to do next and how to approach certain things than to reflect on the imponderable.
Not a guy who looks backward.
Well, I can't say I'm not a guy to look backward.
Well,
I just did, but not from an analytical standpoint, more from telling the story.
Telling the story.
It's a story meant for a particular audience, my own family, present and future. And it's a story meant to be a story of me and through me of a time and a place.
Did you have to leave things out?
I did not.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Not a story, not a person, no.
Well, out of I can't tell a lie. There was one story, which is a trivial little story, but it was trivial enough that I left it out in the editing process. And my wife, who loved that particular incident, gave me a real rough time for leaving it out.
Go, Eva.
So I'm going to have no choice but sticking it back in the paperback edition, assuming there's going to be a paperback edition sometime.
Will you tell me the story now?
Sure. It had to do with me fainting once as a teenager. Went to an outhouse with a friend of mine, a close friend of mine that I described in the book. And there was a very windy day, and the wind slammed the outhouse door on my foot, scraped it in a very painful way, and I collapsed in the outhouse from the shock of the pain.
Yeah.
And I described my reaction coming to and kind of realizing that there was a black hole in my life while I fainted. I couldn't tell whether it was 2 seconds or 2 days.
Yes.
And my own indignation over blacking out and scared and this and that. I mean, it's no big deal, which is why I took it out in the editing. But my wife liked it so well, so she thought it was somehow very much me. So I surrendered. I'm going to put it back.
Can you, with respect to the experiences, one is totalitarianism, fascism, dictatorships, control, governments that occupy, impose their will, absence of freedom of expression, discrimination against religious and ethnic groups. Are you smart about this? I mean, you've gone through this. Does it make you, do you have some sense of being more nervous about it, more fearful of it, more
sensitive about it? I'm very aware of what it is like to be a minority that's picked upon. And I'm going to give you an example since you brought up the September 11 and its aftermath. I was horrified over what happened. I was depressed over what happened. But very soon after that, I started worrying about all those poor Middle Easterns who are going to get singled out, who have nothing whatsoever to do with it. They're going to be singled out because they are part of an ethnic group that has something to do with this. And sure enough, some incidents happened along that line, but I kind of anticipated that they would, and I really felt for them. I think I felt for them because I kind of knew, there for the grace of God go I, have gone. I'm pretty sensitive to that. I'm pretty sensitive to accepting people as individuals as a result of probably the reaction to not having been accepted as an individual.
Do you believe in this emotion that doesn't kill me makes me stronger?
Only somebody who hasn't gone through shit would come up with a phrase like that.
It doesn't do that.
I don't know if it does or not, but it's a very, very pitiful consolation prize. That
it's
one
not
has
worth
to tell
it.
You the thought that the way I would complete that sentence, that one doesn't kill you, might very well have. I don't recommend it as a treatment for strength building.
Mm-hmm. Who are the heroes here?
In the book, mm-hmm. My mother, my father. I had a very supportive set of parents, one of whom wasn't around during the most critical years. He was fighting for his own life. Russian prison
right.
camp. My mother, I dedicate a book to my mother. I say in the dedication that for giving me life more than once, and I mean exactly that. I mean, my mother sheltered me from the worst of the war.
Sent you away.
Hid me.
Right.
Nurtured me. Protected me. Protected me by teaching me how to act and how to respond to certain things at a ridiculously young age. Acted as my father was gone for 3 to 4 years during the toughest period of time. Acted as the head of our family. It's kind of hard to come up with a hero that comes close to that.
Why do you think that you've gone through all this and emerged with an extraordinarily successful life and part of an extraordinary time in America, a leader in that time, been recognized as Time Magazine's Man of the Year, which per se is an honor, but at the same time, it's a reflection of something you did. Why Andy?
I'll answer that, but don't dismiss my answer. I was extraordinarily lucky. I give you an example of my luck. I got out of school, went to work for Fairchild. My first assignment was having to do with the analysis of the basic transistor structure, device structure, out of which modern integrated circuits are made. It was a brand new field. Somebody had the thought of putting me on the foundation work of the brand new field. Weeks out of school, I was one of the world's experts on a nascent emerging field in which there were no experts, so therefore, because I knew something about it, I became one of the experts. I was lucky because I got involved with Gordon Moore, who saw things in me that I didn't see in myself. I had the opportunity to follow him to Intel as a consequently. Now, you know, I'm kind of a persnickety fellow. I make the most of whatever opportunities I have. So I'm not saying I didn't work at these, but I made some choices that I didn't have the right to be as lucky about in terms of career. I had some breaks. I had some people like the Professor Schmidt that I describe in the book, like my PhD advisor, Andy Akervos, like Gordon Moore, who have nurtured me and supported me in a completely unselfish fashion along my career. What other word can you put on that luck?
What was it? Someone once said that luck is where preparation meets opportunity.
That's approximately true, but the way I see it is you, for the most part, you can't create opportunity, but when life provides you with opportunity, it's up to you to make the most of that opportunity, and I try to do that. But I'm very mindful that had I not had one or several of those opportunities, the same characteristics, the same perseverance, the same hard work wouldn't have led to the same results.
Why swimming across?
Well, there's a story in the book that kind of gives it the literal reason. Should I tell the story?
Yes. I chose to ask it at this time.
Pardon?
I chose to ask it at this time.
Okay. You are the boss, so you set the timing. Someplace in the middle of high school, the equivalent to high school, there was a parent-teacher conference where my favorite high school teacher, Mr. Volensky, who was my physics teacher, the real character of a guy, was haranguing the assorted parents in the room and told the story. Says, ladies and gentlemen, life is a lake, like a lake. And all these youngsters get in one side of the lake and they all start swimming. And not every one of them are going to make it across. In fact, in this class, I'm only sure of one guy that's going to make it across, and that's, I said my name in Hungarian. So my parents came home and told me the story, really, really pleased and proud. And that kind of became a metaphorical story.
Making it across.
Making it across, swimming across.
Swimming across. I'm glad you did this. I really am.
I'm glad I did that too. It feels good at this point.
The book, I said, is a memoir, Andrew S. Grove Swimming Across. Two things should be said about this. Number one is that the proceeds for this book go to the International Rescue Committee. Secondly, if you look at this cute little kid here, there is something else there, which is in faint visibility. What?
The words of my father that he wrote on the back of some old pictures while he was very, very ill in prison camp. He thought he was dying. He was saying goodbye to my mother and myself. And as it turns out, he did not die. And he brought those pictures home, and I have them in my possession. And those are the words of his goodbye.
Probably the most prized possession you have, I guess.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
In 1997, CNN terrorism analyst Peter Bergen interviewed Osama bin Laden. He is one of only a handful of Western journalists ever to gain close access to bin Laden. Prior to September 11th, Bergen was putting the finishing touches on a book that has now become very timely. The book is Holy War Incorporated, Inside the Secret World of Osama bin Laden. I'm pleased to have Peter Bergen here to talk about, obviously, bin Laden. Welcome.
Thank you.
You just said to me, and fascinating, which is not a new idea, but you said it with, I think, more knowledge, that this construct that's happened on September 11th was carefully planned and in a series of steps. Tell me what you meant.
I think that, I mean, one of the hallmarks of bin Laden's al-Qaeda organization is patience. It took them 5 years to attack the U.S. embassies in Africa. They started planning in 93, it happened in 98. The bombing of the USS Cole in Yemen took 2 years to plan. Clearly, the Trade Center took a long time to plan. We don't know exactly how long because the investigation is still ongoing.
Or whether it was connected to 93 or not, that kind of thing.
Well, you know, I mean, I believe that in a way, 93 was a dress rehearsal.
Right.
The other thing is to do the unexpected. No one expected U.S. embassies in Africa to be bombed. No one expected the U.S. warship in Yemen to be attacked. No one expected the Trade Center and Pentagon events, obviously. And finally, you know, the other hallmark is ever greater in complexity and deadliness of these attacks. I mean, bin Laden started attacking American targets in 92. There was an attack on U.S. hotels in Yemen. Not U.S. hotels, but hotels housing American servicemen. There were no American casualties. And that very small event, almost unnoticed in 92, is the beginning of an exponentially rising graph with the Trade Center at the end in terms of deadliness and complexity. And the question is, are we at the end of the graph, or is there a point beyond which al-Qaeda will go? And clearly, it would be wishful thinking of the First Order to assume that they won't go beyond that.
What might be beyond that?
We know from bin Laden's own statements on nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons that it's not a crime for them to try and get these weapons as a method of, let's say, equalizing the battlefield. We know from bin Laden's organization's own actions that they've sought to acquire fissile bomb-grade uranium in the 90s, early 90s, that they experimented in an amateur way with chemical weapons. We don't know anything about biological, at least on the public record. The anthrax question is still an open one. But nonetheless, his public statements on these weapons of mass destruction are discomforting, to put it mildly. And since his public statements have generally been the best sort of roadmap to his actions, I think we need to take those statements very seriously. And the videotape that was released on October 7th by bin Laden during the first aerial assault by the United States on against Afghanistan actually references something that has referenced in the past, but it references Hiroshima and Nagasaki in a sort of elliptical way, which to me was an indicator why in the 6-minute speech that he would make would he reference this particular aspect of things. And I think if I was to make a prediction, and as you know, predictions are invidious, but I think that a dirty nuclear bomb, meaning a truck bomb with some sort of uranium waste, is certainly within their capabilities, and certainly within, since all bets are off, as far as I can say, certainly something that they might employ in the future.
Where?
My bet is, again, predictions are invidious, but in the Middle East or Asia, perhaps against an American target. partly because they don't, you know, they're not in the business of repeating the same kind of operation. I don't see them doing a big attack against a significant American target as the next step. They'll do something where the United States government is not looking.
Mm. You believe he's prepared to die and has already factored that in?
Absolutely, because, and the reason I say that is, there's an interesting anecdote, and maybe bravado on his part, but he's told his followers that when he came under a Russian bombardment during the 1980s war in the Soviet, in Afghanistan against the Soviet Union, that he was so at peace with the whole event that he fell asleep. Now, that's quite a different kind of opponent than, let's say, Saddam Hussein, who may be a bad guy, but is clearly interested in his self-preservation. I don't think bin Laden is interested at this point in his self-preservation.
Is he any different from his lieutenants in that way?
I think they've all signed on to the notion that that they may die in this, or will die in this, and one of the hallmarks...
There's no way out, so to speak.
Yeah, yeah, clearly not. I think that the most pessimistic construct you can put on September 11th is that it was sort of a giant come-on. If you look at the actions of the organization so far, it's clear that they've thought through, at least up to this point, what they're planning to do. They eliminated Ahmad Shah Massoud, the most effective guerrilla commander, leader of the Northern Alliance.
With the hope that he would not be able to easily lead Northern Alliance and the United Front in terms of a post-Taliban government.
Well, if, you know, 1 in 100,000 Americans could probably tell you who the military commander of the Northern Alliance is now.
Right.
You know, I mean, the replacement is somebody with doesn't have the battlefield skills or the charisma or the ability to bring together this Northern Alliance, which is, after all, made up of lots of different ethnic groups that have warred together previously.
But that seems to be an act of survival. I mean, in other words, in order to kill him means that you're trying to survive because you don't want someone with his skills who's clearly, you are his sworn enemy.
Yeah, I think it's eliminating what would have been the United States principle. The first thing the United States would have done would be call Massoud and say, okay, what's the plan that we're going to do together?
Yeah.
And none of the people in the Northern Alliance have your stature. It's just a fact.
1997, you get a call.
Yeah.
Saying, come meet. Well, you tell me.
Yeah. 1997. The sequence of events, 1996, the U.S. State Department issues a quite informative white paper saying bin Laden is the most significant funder of Islamic extremism in the world. He's got these training camps in Sudan and Afghanistan. This is, at that point, I became interested in maybe trying to arrange an interview with him. Luckily, I had the kinds of bosses at CNN that, you know, would give you the time and money to go and do that. Made the calls, and after all, bin Laden was still somewhat obscure at that point, and made the calls and went to London.
And who do you call for something like that?
I called his sort of media representative or contact in London, and he said, basically, we're not going to chat about this on the phone for obvious reasons. Come to London and we'll talk in more detail. So I spent about a week in his company on and off. We talked sort of a lot about the Quran and Saudi politics and not very much about the actual how do we get this interview, which was obviously my main concern. But basically, I think we had to persuade him that we'd give him a fair hearing, that we weren't agents of the CIA, which was a big concern. And then I went back to the United States. Peter Arnett, the veteran war correspondent, veteran Peter, mm-hmm. Peter Arnett, of course, was a correspondent. We traveled to London. Peter and I then flew to Pakistan, joined by a cameraman who'd probably spent more time in Afghanistan than anyone else, a man by the name of Peter Juvenal. We then drove across the Khyber Pass into Afghanistan. And we basically had to sit around for quite a long time waiting for... There were sort of a variety of different sort of hoops we had to go through, various levels of green light.
What's a long time? Sit around for a long time?
Well, it felt like weeks, but it was probably, I don't know, 5 or 6 days. Yeah. Finally, his media advisor comes to our room and looks over the equipment and says, you know, you can't bring any of this equipment with you, which is a bit of a blow to the... The Taliban had banned filming the week before we arrived, so that was one problem. And then, you know, there have been Bin Laden people saying, you can't film this with your camera equipment because we're concerned it might conceal a tracking device. Anyway, in the end, they supplied their own camera. And we gave you
the tape.
Yeah. And they told us, you know, when you come and finally come for this interview, you can't bring anything with you except your clothes you're wearing. Because, again, this concern that we might be somehow concealing a tracking device. The day of the interview, a van arrived at our hotel. It was dusk, and it was a sort of curtain minivan. Three heavily armed men inside. Peter Arnett and Peter Juvenal and myself get in the van. We have no idea where we're going or how this is all going to end up. And then we drive. Basically, the sun is setting. We drive into towards Kabul, the capital. We pull off on a road, and we're transferred into another vehicle. We're given some sort of blindfold type over our eyes, and then we find ourselves in a jeep with tinted windows. We're going ever higher into the mountains. It's March. It's pretty cold. We arrive at a hut at about 5,000 feet, and that's where we're going to do the interview. We have something to eat. Bin Laden arrives about an hour later out of the darkness, surrounded by his entourage, a translator,
and how many guards?
I think there were about 20 people, I think, in total, that were maybe somewhere between 20 and 30 that we saw in the course of the evening, I think.
Your first impression of him?
He's very tall.
6'5".
He's your height, I think.
Yes.
And he's,
6'3 and 3'4". He's a tall guy.
He bears himself with sort of a rather aristocratic demeanor. He is, he walked with a cane. He wasn't in great sort of physical shape. I mean, reports that he's suffering from heart disease or cancer are premature, shall we say, because I mean he's not suffering from these types of things, but he's suffering. Anybody who's running around the Afghan mountains, you know, from house to house, and you know you're going to have some health problems. He's got low blood pressure. He has a wound in his foot from the war. That's why he's walking with a cane. But he was all business. I mean, there was no big chit chat. He just basically wanted to do the interview and leave. He lingered for a few minutes after the interview, serving us cups of tea. But you know, I think that you know it wasn't like he was trying to make a personal connection.
Why did he want to do it?
I think he decided to go public. At that point, we wouldn't have known this at the time, but the embassy bombing attack would have been getting into its more or less advanced stages by now, and because this was March of 97 that we met. I think that he wanted to go public with this call to attack Americans. As you know, a year later, he did an interview with John Miller of ABC News. In our interview, it was interesting because he basically said, we're calling for attacks against American soldiers. And if American civilians get in the way, that's kind of their problem. By the time he meets with John Miller in 98, he is saying, or any American is basically the target of our plan. By that time, of course, he must have known that the embassy bombing attacks in Africa were 9 weeks after that interview, and that they were imminent. So you've seen a sort of evolution of his, sort of more radical attacks against Americans in his rhetoric. But why he chose to do this, I think he basically wanted to tell the world that he was at war with Americans. And I think a lot of people took that as sort of rhetorical flourish. It turned out to be, you know, deadly serious.
Do you believe that, I think you do, that the Clinton administration's response by bombing the Sudan and bombing his camps in Afghanistan was a mistake?
A mistake is interesting. I mean, attacks on two U.S. embassies in two different countries is an act of war against the United States.
You cannot
let it pass. There are two problems with the way it was done, and it really goes to the lack of the kind of intelligence failure. One, the attack against the Sudan alleged chemical weapons plant turned out to be a pharmaceutical plant by almost every account. Sure. The other, and also the attacks on Bin Laden, there was supposed to be a meeting of Bin Laden and his top lieutenants in the camps in Afghanistan that were attacked. That was the rationale for attacking on August the 20th, the day in 1998 when it happened. That was absolutely wrong. There was no meeting.
There was no meeting at all. He was never there. I mean, the story
was
that he was there.
Yeah.
I've heard this story, that he was there and he'd gone, or that when the bombing came, he hadn't shown up, that somehow they missed him by a couple of hours because the range that they understood he was going to be there. Yeah.
There was a fascinating story. Mohammed Odeh, who was one of the bombers of the U.S. Embassy in Africa, told an FBI agent that on August the 6th, which is the day before the U.S. Embassy were attacked in Africa, that he was told that the top leadership had evacuated the camps in Afghanistan because they were expecting retaliation from the U.S. Navy. Now that shows a very well-informed understanding of the form, type of U.S. retaliation, not U.S. Special Forces, not the U.S. Air Force, but the U.S. Navy, i.e. Tomahawk cruise missiles that are sort of standoff weapons which is exactly how the attack did happen on August 20th, 1998. So I think that they understood, they'd evacuated, I mean, Bin Laden, there's a commonsensical reason that Bin Laden would not have been in that camp, because that was the camp where he gave the interview to John Miller of ABC News and a press conference to 28 Pakistani journalists just several weeks before. Why would he, this would replace it, he'd announced to the world that he was going to attack Americans, why would he hang around?
Yeah.
I mean, it was a mistake. And of course, the tax finally had the unintended consequence of turning him from a sort of minor figure, essentially, to a global celebrity.
I mean, that's really what the consequence was.
That was, yeah.
I mean, on 60 Minutes, too, George Carlin went over there, and, you know, last summer, and he's got, I mean, that was the stunning, you know, essence of his report.
Yeah.
That attack made him into, it gained him far more adherence than it did any damage to him.
Unfortunately, the case. But again, I mean, they were in a quandary. You can't let... How can you let that go unresponded to? It just goes to the question that the intelligence was faulty.
Do you have any sense of, what do you think of the bombing? I mean, do you think it is effective, is essential, it has to be done, it softens up the Taliban, and therefore you can do more later?
I mean,
and they might get lucky and...
I'm no military analyst. I mean, I don't...
I understand that.
But I mean, and I think the Taliban are, you know, I mean, I was flipping through some old newspapers, and there was a headline on October 17th in the Washington Post, Pentagon, Taliban's eviscerated, it said.
Yeah.
You know, clearly not. And the Taliban is not a monolithic movement. There are people who will, you know, who join the Taliban because they basically saw an inexorable force and they decided to join, or they were paid to join, or whatever. Those people will fall away at a certain point. But the inner core, half the Taliban cabinet have war wounds. I mean, Mullah Omar, who runs the Taliban,
has lost
an eye. These are not people who are necessarily particularly worried about being in a war. They've known war for the last 22 years, and the older members, anybody leading the Taliban has fought against the Soviet Union. In their own mind, their efforts defeated a superpower. They're just not that intimidated, in my view.
What was the most searing impression of Bin Laden?
You know, I mean, we only spent perhaps an hour and a half with him. And it's difficult to make any. I mean, the thing that
does he speak softly? Does he speak strongly?
He spoke. He was very, very soft-spoken, and his words obviously were filled with rage. The thing that struck me about him was that he was very serious. I mean, this is a very serious individual. You know, you don't abandon your life of, you know, the typical Saudi multimillionaire has a Paris and Jeddah and goes to Monte Carlo and London. This is, you know, he never did that. And that's part of his attraction for his followers. They know
they say he made a sacrifice to come with us.
Right. In Hollywood, he's got a great backstory, which is attractive not only to people in the media like ourselves, but also to his followers, because they see that he really did sacrifice and that he's living in this humble way. And you, no matter what you think about, I mean, his actions have obviously been extremely evil. Yet there is something in his message and the way that he conducts his life that is very appealing to his followers.
When you think about those members of Al-Qaeda who somehow have been captured, you think they'll talk? And are they talking? And you must have sources that tell you. What are they saying?
Well, you know, I don't know much about the present investigation. My understanding is that if you're really a member of Al-Qaeda, you don't talk. I mean, a good example...
Well, what is it? I mean, some kind of... What? Some kind of code of silence?
Well, there's an interesting real-life example, which is Ahmed Rassam, who came to the United States to bomb the Los Angeles International Airport. He was arrested, as you remember, at the border of Seattle. He didn't talk for 14 months. He didn't say anything. The United States officials thought he was planning to bomb. They didn't know if it was a Space Needle in Seattle. Seattle canceled its Millennium celebrations. They didn't know if it was San Francisco. They didn't know. They knew it was on the West Coast. That's all they knew. He kept silence. It was only when he was facing 130 years in prison that he decided to talk and say the target was Los Angeles International Airport. So, you know, and he's somebody, you know, essentially he decided not to throw the rest of his life away and maybe get some kind of deal. But, you know, it's quite a disciplined thing just not to say anything for 13 or 14 months. And so I think my impression is from the 10 people that really appear to be some way related, they aren't cooperating with U.S. authorities. So, you know, I mean, unless these people start facing some very serious time, the one thing that to me is sort of interesting is there's no indictment in the World Trade Center attacks yet. If we're trying to persuade our allies or not our allies that Bin Laden's really responsible, it seems that getting an indictment would be step number one. I mean, what are the
only thing I can think of that might be an incentive not to do it is that they don't want to show what they have right now. They don't want to put their cards on the table.
Yeah. At what point does that trump the fact, you know, the political considerations of keeping the coalition together? There is an indictment, by the way, in the USS Cole attack in Yemen, 2000, which Bin Laden, I think, is clearly behind. But that's, you know, it's taking some time. There is the indictment in the U.S. embassy attacks in Africa.
This book is called Holy War: Inside the Secret World of Osama Bin Laden. Peter Bergen wrote this, started this while working at CNN. Still working at CNN?
Yes, as a
consultant.
Yeah.
Great to have you here. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Ernst Gombrich, perhaps the world's best-known art historian, died Saturday in London at the age of 92. He was the author of The Story of Art, which became a standard history. The book sold millions of copies and was translated into 23 languages. It helped reshape the study of visual culture during the second half of the 20th century. He was a lover of classical music and was a teacher for generations at the University of London and the Warburg Institute of London. During World War II, he worked for the BBC as a radio monitor of German broadcast. In 1945, he dispatched the news of Hitler's death to Churchill. I interviewed Ernst Gombrich in 1995, and tonight we remember him with a look back at that conversation. This is an extraordinary book, as you well know, and as people have praised. How did it come into being?
More or less by accident, there's so many things in life.
Yeah.
It came into being because I had once had the commission to write a history of the world for children. When I was still in Vienna as a young man, I wrote this, which happened to be a great success, and I was asked now to write a history of art for children. My reply was that the history of art isn't for children. But when they went on pressing me, I said I could write it, but not for children. And that is how this book roughly came into being, that I decided to make this attempt. And after a number of interruptions due to the war and other reasons, I even tried to finish it.
Why do you think it's met with such acceptance?
I think, or I hope, it is because I don't try to give myself airs. I don't try to make a mystery of things which are not a mystery, but I admit that there are mysteries which one needn't discuss because they are too obviously mysteries.
You also have said before, and correct me if I'm wrong, because the fact that it's said does not necessarily mean you said it, that the story of art makes a difference, that is the story of art.
That is entirely true. I'm glad that you mentioned this. The story in the sense that it is not just a chronicle of one thing after another. There's a chronicle of fashion, for instance, but the development of image making is a story insofar as there is a story also behind the development of flying or other achievements of mankind, insofar as people strove for certain aims and passed on their achievements to others. And so there's a coherence in the story which one can tell as a chain of events which hangs together.
Yeah, that seems to be what everybody seems to like so much about it. It is, in fact, what you have brought to bear is the connection and the unfolding story.
That's what I try to do, yes.
What about modern art?
Modern art is an interesting point in this respect, because my story, in a certain sense, is a story of the conflict between two opposing problems or methods of representing the world, which in a simplified form you can say you draw what you know or you draw what you actually see. And I explained that the Egyptians drew in that sense what they knew rather than what they saw in front of them. And that this development went as far as Impressionism, where the principle of what was called the innocent eye, really looking at what you actually see, triumphed. This happened at the end of the 19th century, and the problem of the coming of what was to happen afterwards is represents really the story of our century. So when you ask what about modern art is confronted with a certain break in that chain and the search for very different solutions. I tried to explain in the book that one of the reasons for this break was that in a sense the theory which was underlying Impressionism is a little too simple. We can never completely separate what we know from what we see, and therefore the whole idea broke down, and I should have added, and I did add in a later page, that photography had a lot to do with this too. So the search for alternative, what an artist, an image maker can do, was on, and it still goes on all the time.
You have never been a great collector.
I've never been a great or a minor collector.
Or a minor collector.
Yes.
Why is that?
First of all, I had never a lot of money.
Yeah, well, that's a start. But I know good collectors who didn't start with a lot of money.
That is true. I have no possessive instincts. I'm very happy when I see a great painting in a great gallery or museum, and I don't feel, oh, I wish I would own that. I'm very happy that it's there where it is.
To enjoy it in the museum.
Exactly.
You, or the gallery. But you do have prints.
My father was a print collector, and I own a number of pleasant prints and even quite valuable prints.
Yeah.
Yes.
Let me take you back to Vienna.
Yes.
Your mother knew and was friends with Gustav Mahler and also Sigmund Freud.
Yes. She knew Sigmund Freud very well. I wouldn't say that she was friends with Sigmund Freud.
That's right. And who was? What did she tell you about them, and what was their...
Well, she told me many things. She said that Sigmund Freud was the best teller of Jewish jokes she had ever encountered.
And Mahler?
Mahler was a difficult man, as you know, a man with a nervous tic and with a great difficulty. But she admired him very much as a person.
Yeah.
And
music.
As a musician.
Yeah. Did you grow up with a greater sense of music than painting?
Absolutely, yes. Certainly. Music played a central part in my family and in our house.
Yeah. Were you the first person in London to know of Hitler's death?
Yes, so I always tell, and I'm pretty sure it's true. I mean, I listened.
How did that happen?
What happened was that towards the very end of the war, there was one of these announcements on the German wireless that stand by for an important announcement, and it was pretty obvious that this was had to do with Hitler. And so I was called in as a more experienced listener, and I had the idea that to make it as quickly as possible to pass on the news when it came, I wrote on pieces of paper, Hitler abdicates, Hitler dead, Hitler surrenders, and so on and so forth. So when the voice came and said, our Führer has fallen in the struggle against Bolshevism, I pointed to the right piece of paper, and they quickly rang up Downing Street and
to tell Churchill. Now, was Churchill asleep? What time of day was it?
I don't think he was asleep. Yeah. I think it was not far from lunchtime.
Now, when did they play Wagner?
They didn't play at that time Wagner, they played Bruckner. They played a slow movement from one of Bruckner's symphony, which Bruckner had written to commemorate the death of Wagner.
Ah.
And I recognized this fact, and so I had an inkling what was coming.
Yeah. Was there ever any interest on your part in becoming a musician with all the music that was part of your family?
No, certainly not. I lack the talent.
You lack the talent?
Yes, I think so.
And you were a professor at Oxford?
I was also a professor at Oxford.
Yeah. And after the publication of this, what happened?
Well, I was invited to many places to give lectures or to teach and give seminars. And this I did very often in the United States, but elsewhere as well.
Yeah. And when were you knighted?
I think it was in 72, but I'm not quite sure. You will have to look it up in the reference book.
Your favorite artist? Who have...
I don't think I have a favorite artist. You know, I don't give marks to artists. Yeah. I admire some artists tremendously, but when I then see the work of another, I say, well, he's also wonderful. But I admire, for instance, Velázquez enormously.
Yeah.
I admire Chardin enormously. Artists, in other words, whose métier, whose painting is so totally marvelous in the way they put on paint on canvas, that it is miraculous.
Ernst Gombrich, who died last week in London at age 92. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, a conversation with Andy Grove, the chairman of Intel, his personal story of surviving Nazis and Soviets. Join us.